exploring stillness and engagement. I chose this topic because I wanted to investigate what life's been like for me, for all of us, this past few months. They've been extraordinary and challenging. And I hope at the end, when we have some time to discuss, that you will share some of your own experiences and insights going through these past several months. Suddenly, my entire world changed when the pandemic hit. We knew very little about the novel coronavirus. How is it transmitted? What are the risk factors? How do we mitigate the risks? There were so many unknowns. We were all in a state of not knowing in relation to this threat that could affect all our lives around the globe. I started to have weird dreams. I dreamed, for example, of being in a pitch dark room, not knowing where the door was, where the furniture lay, nothing, complete disorientation. Then I started having a series of dreams about villains who seemed innocuous, kind of like the invisible virus, but they were definitely threatening my life. So as I explored these challenges, I realized this was going to be a time like we've never experienced before. I did not know how my life would be affected, how the lives of people I loved, my family in different parts of the world, would be affected. Then came the lockdowns. I remember the first day of the Florida lockdown. I woke, lay in bed, and realized none of the activities that I would normally have done that day were possible. And with this realization came the understanding of the extent to which I shaped the reality of my day with the activities I used to fill the day. So now, in order to get the motivation to bring up the energy to actually get out of bed, I had to create a new pattern of activities. I had to reimagine the day, my life, and have a whole new structure to it. We all had to do this, and it's very disconcerting. It produces a lot of anxiety. This is natural. So to kind of ground myself, I took stock of the resources I had to restructure my world. I had my family and friends, so I've stayed connected with them, and that's really helped. I had my dog, I had my meditation practice, and I had nature around my house. And I've had to tap into all of these resources and more. So as I continued to explore, I paid more attention to nature. And it seemed like the birds had raised their volume by several decibels. Did you notice that? I don't think I imagined it. It was as if the birds were rejoicing that all of us humans in lockdown were not engaging in as many destructive behaviors as we usually do. I saw amazing photographs of smog-free Los Angeles and New Delhi on my computer screen. I figured nature is doing a course correction. What is she trying to teach us, and me in particular? I started spending more time in nature. For example, I took my afternoon tea each day to the backyard, and I engaged in direct contemplation of nature. My travel itinerary had changed dramatically. Instead of San Francisco and Sri Lanka, it had changed to bedroom and backyard. So I decided I needed to find beauty where I could in my everyday surroundings and joy in unexpected places, like in my routine tasks. As I sat in my backyard, looking out at nature, I realized that beneath the activity in nature, there's a lot of activity in nature. But beneath that, beneath the rustling leaves, beneath the songs of the ground thrush and cardinals, beneath the fluttering of all those monarch butterflies in spring, there was a stillness. So I began to explore stillness, slowing down my daily activities, helped me to see some things that I hadn't really paid much attention to before. For example, it helped me to see my unskillful behaviors like anger. What were the triggers? The day I found myself yelling into my phone at the automated response system for UPS on the other side, I could clearly see what was triggering my anger. The UPS automated system was doing its usual loop. Press 1 for domestic, 2 for international. Did you know you could go online and track your shipments? It went on and on. And my frustration rose at not being heard, not having any control over this situation, things not going as I wanted them to. I also started to notice more subtle aversions, just in doing everyday tasks. There were some tasks that I tried to get through as quickly as possible to get to more pleasurable ones. For example, cleaning the house, cooking, I'm not a great cook. Picking up my dog's poop, I love my dog, but her poop, not so much. What was underlying these subtle aversions? I even had aversions to certain poses in my yoga routine, like boat. I have terrible core strength, so I would always cringe when it was coming up. So I started exploring these tasks associated with aversion more. Impermanence and dependent origination. These are the two foundational teachings in Buddhism. I translate them for myself as present moment and interconnectedness. So present moment being impermanence, interconnectedness being dependent origination. I imagined, because we've had many Dharma talks on these topics, dependent origination and impermanence, interconnectedness, present moment, I imagined that I had just heard a Dharma talk on this. And instead of going into sitting practice as we would like in a retreat, with this framework of interconnectedness, present moment, I went into my relaxed body and engaged with the next task I had to do in my house. I remember the first time I washed dishes, being in this framework. Suddenly, there were the fingers, the tactile sensations, the warm water, the smoothness of the white plate. They were all intertwined in this dance. And best of all, my thinking mind did not have to choreograph the dance. There was a sense of stillness, of time stopping. Buddhism teaches that time is a mental construct. So it makes sense that if our mental patterns, our habitual mental patterns begin to change, a sense of time would change as well. So I kept engaging in this, and I noticed that as I would be in the present moment for however short a moment, my sense of kind of background anxiety from the pandemic receded, and a sense of well-being arose. Jeanette talked about this phenomenon in her talk about anxiety, I think a week ago, that when she engaged in a concrete task to help other people, that her sense of anxiety diminished. You don't help other people to diminish the anxiety, it's just a byproduct. And it's something that was very helpful to me at this time. Being in stillness, I could feel the interconnectedness with others and their sense of dis-ease, their anxiety, their suffering, and all those healthcare workers in hospitals desperately trying to take care of the sick and dying with very few resources. I felt the need to engage, to do something, to help. And this is where Dharma Relief One came along. Many of you were involved in Dharma Relief One. Sarah Khan was kind of the mover behind this. And for those of you who are not familiar with it, this was an initiative that Gurgu came up with, and many Dharma teachers around North America and in other countries as well joined in. They raised over $600,000 in 2 weeks and bought 1.2 surgical masks from a trusted manufacturer in China, had them shipped directly to hospitals all across North America, also nursing homes, places that desperately needed PPE, that needed masks. And I found engaging with the other volunteers, even some of the hospital and nursing home staff, even engaging with UPS. That's why I was yelling at my phone at the answering system. This concrete action, however small, really helped to diminish my anxiety and gave me a sense of groundedness in doing a concrete task. I also had some other methods I used to allay the anxiety. I limited my contact with news. I was not checking every few minutes what was happening with the virus. I did not watch TV. Instead, I found videos online for watercolor. And this was a really rewarding, enjoyable activity that helped focus my mind, which I really needed to do. I found a technique that particularly appeals to me. It's called wet on wet. You wet the paper and then you use wet paint and see where the color goes. So you don't have a lot of control in this technique, at least not the way I did it. And to me, it became a practice in letting go, kind of letting go of the anxiety, recognizing I didn't have a lot of control over what was happening globally. So I used these strategies to try to work my way through to some sense of new patterns, new ways of thinking that seemed to help. It was as if with the pandemic, there was a giant global pause. And with that pause came enormous changes across the world. It was at this time, late May, when we saw George Floyd being killed and the resulting protests all around the world. I feel that the pandemic forced us to disengage from many of our distractions and made us realize what's really important in life. So we were ripe when George Floyd was killed with apparent disregard to recognize immediately this racism, this police brutality was wrong and it was unacceptable. We had to do something about it. So when the protests hit, there was an eruption in myself. There were emotions that I had not felt for many years, memories from the distant past, just upwelling of just vexations and anger, great emotions, turmoil, turbulence within me. But because I had engaged in some practice of stillness during the pandemic preceding this, I suddenly realized that the people who had caused suffering to myself, to my husband, our two daughters, through their racism in the past, had themselves suffered from their own racism. There's a Buddhist sutra which teaches that when people are unkind in word and actions, they're actually suffering themselves within. It's because of their suffering internally. So I began to think about this interconnectedness between the races and the people suffering from racism. This was really something difficult to grapple with. And I recognized that I needed to kind of alternate between stillness and engagement, because otherwise there was too much agitation in me, too many vexations. And I started wondering, what does Buddhism teach us about engaging, about activism to change society? Does it even recognize this? So what I found is there's different views, because Buddhism is not a monolith. There are many schools of thought and practice. There were three basic views that I found. The first is that awakening is a solitary activity. Do not concern yourself with the world, because after all, that's samsara. That is what you're trying to get out of. So this is the transcendental view of Buddhism. It's the path that the arahats follow. And to be frank, this path would have really appealed to me when I was much younger. But life had decided that I should follow a different path. There's a second view regarding engagement, which is that first one needs to awaken. So then you could clearly see what needed to be done out in the world that would be most helpful. Otherwise, you might be well-intentioned, but to actually do things that were harmful. This made a lot of sense. It was very logical, but I recognized at my age, if I followed this path, I would never engage with the world. So fortunately, there's a third view in Buddhism. This is the Mahayana Chan view, and that is that stillness and engagement are simultaneous, not sequential. In this view, the Buddha path occurs over three great eons. During these long stretches of time, through practice of compassion, one cultivates the six perfections. So the six perfections are generosity, morality, patience, determination, concentration, and wisdom. In the Chan view, there are two types of wisdom. First, there's fundamental wisdom. This is the wisdom that all awakened people arrive at, whether they follow the transcendental path of the arahats or they follow the bodhisattva path. They all arrive at fundamental wisdom. But in the Chan view, there's a second type of wisdom, which is acquired wisdom. And this is only possible if you engage compassionately with the world. This is how you develop acquired wisdom. There's a sutra, Vimalakirti Sutra, which is really all about this. Vimalakirti is a layperson, not a monk, who has awakened. And he has great acquired wisdom because he engages with people from all walks of life. And therefore, it's Vimalakirti who teaches the senior monks, the disciples of the Buddha, about great compassion. In Mahayana teachings, stillness and meditation is not for the sake of transcendence. It's for the sake of all beings to compassionately engage, not for oneself, but for the sake of all beings. And this is referred to in many ways by many teachers. For example, Thich Nhat Hanh often says, no mud, no lotus. It's in the mud, the muck, the mire of this world that the lotus of compassion can bloom. I also found another quote which I liked in regard to this that I want to read to you. It's from Zen Master Hakuin, late 17th, early 18th century. He says, for penetrating to the depths of one's true nature, nothing can surpass the practice of Zen in the midst of activity. The power of wisdom obtained by practicing Zen in the world of action is like a rose that rises from the fire. It can never be destroyed. The rose that rises from the midst of flames becomes all the more beautiful and fragrant the nearer the fire rages. I also thought about the example of the Buddha himself, the Buddha's life. He was a crown prince. He could have lived very comfortably in his palace, lived a happy life. But instead, seeing the suffering around him, he was compelled to investigate the suffering, the causes of it, and the way out. This was not just an internal change, though that's mostly what we think of is the internal change that the Buddha taught. But he also created a community, a sangha, which was based on very different principles than the prevailing principles of Indian society of his day. It flouted social norms. It did not recognize the caste system, social standing, even gender separation. So the Buddha assessed people not the way society assessed them by these external trappings of caste, social standing. Instead, he assessed them on their behavior, on the depth of their understanding of the teachings, on their practice. I found something interesting about Upali. We still revere Upali to this day, 2,500 years later, when we do gratitude prostrations as Upali, the honored one. Upali was a barber. He was from a low caste, but that didn't really matter. He was still considered a senior disciple of the Buddha in the early Buddhist tradition. So I understood that this community that the Buddha founded was based on very different underpinnings than Indian society at the time. Whatever they had, whatever property they had in this community of renunciates, it was held in common. They made communal decisions. Women could join the Sangha. So Buddhism was really a force for social justice at this time. In more modern times, teachers like Master Chingyen, Thich Nhat Hanh, have popularized engaged Buddhism. Engagement to improve matters in this world is within the practice, within the teachings of Buddhism. I began to think about how I could engage in regard to racism, because I did still have these agitations because of my personal experiences. So I realized, and this is how I continue to this day, I had to alternate between stillness, engagement. I couldn't stay in stillness, but I had to take a break from engagement sometimes to kind of calm down vexations that might arise. So this is around the time when Dharma Relief 2 came along. It's in the formative stages. It's focused on racism. And I also have a few other avenues to engage, like the listening circle on racism that Sandra and I are coordinating and several of you are part of. I mentor a few students. I'm engaged in an election, helping in an election campaign. I do recognize that I need to not overestimate the extent to which I can engage. It's better for me to engage in a few things with calmness, clarity, compassion, than to busy myself with a lot of engagement at the risk of giving rise to vexations and perhaps an increased sense of self. So the interconnectedness that is one of the foundations of Buddhism, I feel, is something that helps to guide me in this path. I recognize as I ground myself in the body, as vexations rise, that when we're angry, our body stiffens, it hardens, it cuts off the connections to the environment, to other people. Alternatively, when we relax in our body, it becomes soft, pliable, and we can feel more readily those currents of interconnections. This is one of my resources that I try to use in engagement. I realize I need to work on the vexations, the three poisons in myself, greed, hatred, ignorance. I also see that these three poisons of greed, hatred, and ignorance undergird racism at a societal level. And we need to work on that as well, together, collectively. So as I engage with this and explore interrelatedness, being in the present, I recognize that the great civil rights leaders, like John Lewis, who we lost recently, they knew about interconnectedness. They recognized that the people who were beating up on them, who were killing them, those people were also suffering. They were suffering from their own racism. They were fettered and imprisoned by their racism. So I want to close with the words of another great civil rights activist, Fannie Lou Hamer. And these words resonate with me, and I feel they resonate with Chan teachings. So back in 1971, this is what Fannie Lou Hamer said. Now, we've got to have some changes in this country, and not only changes for the Black man, and only changes for the Black woman, but the changes we have to have in this country are going to be for liberation of all people, because nobody's free until everybody's free. So now I hope we can have a discussion. I'd really like people to share what they've experienced in these extraordinary times that we're living through, and what insights they've gained from their experiences.